Now, please welcome your host for today's webinar, Rachel Shida.
Thank you, James. Welcome to today's webinar, Addressing Climate Change to Excel Value-Based Care, brought to you by the Healthcare Payment Learning Action Network in partnership with the Department of Health and Human Services Office of Climate Change and Health Equity. We'll take a quick look at today's agenda. We have welcome and opening remarks from Joe McCannon, some introductory remarks from Team Decarbonization and Resilience Initiative through CMS. Then we'll have our panel discussion and closing remarks. If we have time, as James mentioned, we will take questions from the audience, so please feel free to type those in the Q&A. But before we get started, let's take a quick minute to learn a little bit about today's audience with this brief poll. If you could just fill in what kind of stakeholder type you are, that just gives us a sense of who's in the audience. That would be great. Thank you. That's probably good, James. Okay. Oh, we've got some community-based and social service organizations. That's great. Thank you. All right. Well, so now I'd like to introduce our first speaker and panel moderator. He's a senior advisor with the Office of Climate Change and Health Equity, Joe McCannon. Joe?
Rachel, thanks very much. And an appreciation to the Innovation Center and to the Learning and Diffusion Group and to the HCP LAN for having me here with you today. I've been looking forward to the session, in part because this is subject matter that I'm very passionate about and always like to seize the opportunity to share more information about it. And in part because we've got such a great panel who I think are going to share with you some really inspirational ideas and case examples that should help you take some practical action. So I don't want to delay too much in getting to that, but I do just want to set the scene a little bit and talk a little bit about why we're here, both kind of why we're here having this conversation and why we're here as an office, as the Office of Climate Change and Health Equity, in the Department of Health and Human Services. So, you know, the real answer to that question is kind of pictured here. It has everything to do with the climate crisis and its catastrophic impacts, the high-powered storms we're experiencing more frequently, the wildfire smoke that we saw blanket the east coast of the U.S. last summer, and the wildfires, of course, that caused a great deal of mortality in Hawaii last summer, increases in flooding, and maybe above all, extreme heat that has really increased in the last several summers. In fact, there's a data point which suggests that by mid-century, we could see as much as a 200% increase in death, cardiovascular death associated with extreme heat. And of course, we saw examples of this in Maricopa County last summer, where almost 650 people died due to heat-related complications. In addition to these catastrophic impacts, though, you know, there are also kind of a broader set of tentacles, if you will, or sequelae associated with climate change. So there are chronic impacts too. There's cardiovascular health challenges, pulmonary health challenges, increases in allergies, increases in waterborne illness, increases in insect-borne illness, if we think of something like Lyme disease, increases in foodborne illness, increases in mental health challenges associated with climate change. So there's so much to it, which is why more than 200 medical journals made this really kind of unprecedented joint statement in the fall of 2021, which said that climate change today, not 50 years from now, but today represents kind of cumulatively the greatest threat to global public health. You know, that's the degree of seriousness that we're dealing with here. In addition, we know that climate change doesn't just threaten public health; it also threatens normal healthcare operations. So there can be damage to facilities, there can be evacuations required, there can be major access issues, shutdowns in service. All of those are increasing realities. And what you see here is, you know, just a graphical image of the increase in billion-dollar disaster events over the last 40 plus years in this country. These events carry with them those types of complications, which of course can threaten patient outcomes and can introduce costs to payers and providers and patients and families as well. And then on top of this, you know, we know that like most public health challenges in the United States, climate change disproportionately impacts and harms certain populations. So certain groups, due to decades of underinvestment and disenfranchisement and discrimination, are much more exposed and much more vulnerable to climate-related challenges. And I'm talking here about a statistic like the fact that Black people living in the United States are 40% likelier to live in areas with increased risk for extreme heat. Talking about increased risks associated with extreme heat for elderly and disabled populations. If we think of the Medicaid population and Medicaid beneficiaries, moms and babies specifically, increased risks for preterm birth, increased risks for developmental complications, increased risks for chronic disease in kids, particularly in low income and minority populations. So all of this together, if we think about value-based care and what's interesting to this learning community, it means that climate change is kind of has the potential to be this uniquely destructive force where it exacerbates most social determinants of health. If we're thinking about economic opportunity, educational access, the places where people live. And it is, in our view, in and of itself, a social determinant. I mentioned that climate change disproportionately harms certain populations that are already at a great disadvantage. If we think about quality and healthcare services, it undercuts just about every dimension of quality. You know, if you think about a disruption in services that can undermine safety, patient-centeredness, certainly effectiveness, and efficiency. So, you know, we know that, again, climate change introduces these costs that can be really detrimental to the system. What's notable, though, about climate change is that unlike, a pandemic or a new population health challenge, in this case, healthcare itself has some direct control or can contribute to solving the problem upstream, because we know that healthcare is a that healthcare system is a major contributor itself to climate change. Estimates are that it contributes, 8 to 9% of carbon emissions in the country. These are emissions associated with direct on-site burning of energy. Clinical care byproducts like waste anesthetic gases that have high global warming potential, emissions associated with purchased energy if it's not clean energy, and emissions associated with, above all, with the value chain or the supply chain. So, the drugs and supplies and materials that are where they're sourced from and manufactured and transported, there are great emissions associated with that too. So, I think the good news is that there are concrete strategies and solutions to address that, some of which we'll hear about here today. And the other good news is that value-based care itself can be a major and helpful contributor. So, I think we entitled this session Addressing Climate Change to Accelerate Value-Based Care, but we could have probably as easily called it, Addressing Value-Based Care to Accelerate Climate Health. If we make investments in upstream health and environmental health, if we utilize healthcare services more thoughtfully and introduce strategies like telehealth, which limit transportation, if we reduce waste in the delivery of care, both sort of clinical waste and other physical waste, and we manage operations more efficiently, that can all contribute to the solutions that we seek. So it's all of this, the need to help the health system become more resilient, And communities become more resilient from health risks and the need to mobilize the healthcare sector that led to the creation of the Office of Climate Change and Health Equity. And, you know, our office was called for by the Biden administration, not because there hadn't been work on HHS on this in the past through CDC and NIH and the Assistant Secretary for Preparedness and Response, but because the administration felt that there should be a single entity, a kind of a focal point for catalyzing all of HHS to take action. So we were called for by executive order in January of 2021, stood up in August of 2021 in the Office of the Assistant Secretary for Health, Admiral Rachel Levine, who's a great proponent of this work. And our vision has been an ambitious one since then, which is, you know, in the next 5 years, mobilize community and healthcare communities and healthcare organizations such that they are prepared for the health challenges that I described, such that they avoid the disruptions in operations that I described, and such that they're actually tackling their own emissions in a pretty ambitious way. And the goal again is to get all of HHS, all of its agencies to be engaged in this work. We started on this work ourselves by declaring very clear goals and very clear objectives related to what HHS will do and what federal health systems will do. We included this in the HHS strategy for the first time. And an executive order 14057 requires all federal facilities, including federal health facilities, to decarbonize on a pace with the Biden administration's goals, getting to net zero by 2050 with ambitious milestones along the way. And then we also issued an invitation to the private sector to match us and match our ambition through something called the White House HHS Health Sector Climate Pledge. And this has had more than 130 organizations join, almost 950 hospitals represented. And these hospitals, together with federal facilities, represent 15 to 20% of all the hospitals in the country. A lot of suppliers, pharmaceutical companies, group purchasing organizations, insurers have also come to the table as well. So there's been good mobilization, but the challenge for us has been, okay, so how do we actually support change, move from commitments to actual change in the system? And you know, for us, we've focused heavily on developing forecasting tools to support that. We have something called the Climate and Health Outlook, which comes out every month and forecasts climate-related risks and strategies for addressing those. It's meant developing tools for clinicians, like a referral guide we have to help with the challenges of the summer season. It's meant developing a health resources hub where we collect everything related to healthcare resilience and sustainability. But above all, in the last year, our focus has been on the Inflation Reduction Act and the transformative potential that that has to really fuel action in the health sector. It's billions of dollars in this historic climate legislation that through tax credits and grants and loans and other programs can be invested in a variety of things, including renewable on-site energy, so solar microgrids, wind, other sources of renewable energy, energy efficiency projects like improving HVAC systems or introducing LED lighting, low emissions transportation projects, introducing clean vehicles and associated charging infrastructure, increased building resilience through hardening projects and projects to lift power plants off lower floors, and community resilience funds as well. And what's really remarkable and kind of historic is that nonprofit organizations, tax-exempt organizations, can access a lot of the tax credits that make these investments possible. So whereas historically tax credits were for this type of work were only available to taxable entities, now tax-exempt organizations can receive these credits in the form of direct payments, which is really powerful. And what this can mean potentially in terms of savings is significant. This is data from the Department of Energy working with a cohort of organizations where they recognized almost $400 million in savings through some retrofits work that they did. So all of the resources and opportunities related to the Inflation Reduction Act are captured in something we call the Quick Finder, which distills the relevant opportunities for the health sector. And in a webinar series we had called the Catalytic Program on the IRA, and you can get those through the QR codes there. But it's important to say that, you know, this is just what our office has been focusing on. And as I said, a lot has been happening across the rest of HHS, from SAMHSA to the Administration for Children and Families to CDC to, I think in the last year, really maybe above all, CMS, which has really become engaged, issuing a really important waiver to allow for microgrids to fund emergency background power. So clean energy microgrids instead of diesel. And also waivers from Medicaid to allow states to make investments in beneficiaries having access to air conditioning and air filtration and so forth, mold remediation. So there's really a lot that's happened from CMS. And what I'm going to turn to my colleagues, Michael and Dilly, to talk about now are an exciting announcement that CMMI made along these lines just in the last few weeks. Michael.
Great. Thanks so much, Joe. So I'm Michael De La Guardia. I'm a Deputy Director of the Division for Health Plan Innovation at the CMS Innovation Center and work on much of our climate and decarbonization work. But we're very excited for today's session and the focus on climate change and value-based care. With our time here today, I'll share a recent announcement by the Innovation Center to help address climate change and health sector emissions while simultaneously reducing healthcare costs and improving health outcomes. So you might ask, why is the Innovation Center stepping into climate change policy? And Joe previewed a little bit of this, but you may say, after all, we are an organization within CMS that was created to test new and innovative payment and delivery system reform models in Medicare and Medicaid with the goal of improving quality and reducing costs. And the short answer is that climate change driven by greenhouse gas emissions threatens patients' health. And efforts to address these impacts could both improve the quality of care and health outcomes for Medicare and Medicaid beneficiaries, and has the potential to reduce costs due to energy efficiency and directly contribute to Medicare savings. And I should add that we are the Innovation Center, so it is our job, our responsibility to push the envelope and test new ideas. So with that in mind, in early April, we proposed a new episode-based payment model that would start in January 2026, the Transforming Episode Accountability Model, TEAM. The payment model would be mandatory for acute care hospitals selected to participate, and participating hospitals would be accountable for ensuring people with Medicare receive coordinated, high-quality care during the procedure and the 30 days following discharge. But within this mandatory model, and more relevant to today's session, we've also proposed a voluntary decarbonization and resilience initiative comprised of two major elements. The first is a voluntary greenhouse gas emissions reporting system, and the second, an opportunity to receive technical assistance and learning system support for participants undertaking decarbonization activities. The voluntary emissions reporting system focuses on four key data types. The first is organizational. These include questions such as whether the hospital or health system has established an executive sustainability team, set decarbonization goals within their organization, and or are implementing a decarbonization plan. Then the second element would be building energy and emissions. So using the Energy Star Portfolio Manager program, hospitals would report scope 1 and scope 2 greenhouse gas emissions data, as well as their facility's Energy Star score and related data such as energy source, usage data, and energy use intensity. Some have asked why we stopped at scope 1 and scope 2 and didn't include scope 3. The answer here is that we weren't sure what reporting for scope 3 should look like exactly. And I'm sure some on this panel may have a few ideas, but as part of the public comment period, we're asking for input on how we can standardize and collect scope 3 data in the future. So we direct your attention to that RFI that was included as part of the proposed rule. The third area of reporting is anesthetic gas emissions. This reporting would include total emissions from inhaled anesthetic gases, anesthetic gas purchase records, questions about plans to lower the use of desflurane, which traps heat at a rate of 2,500 times that of carbon dioxide, and then decommissioning pipe nitrous oxide while substituting e-cylinders. So a number of best practice questions and a mix here of quantitative and qualitative questions. And then the final reporting area is scope one transportation emissions. Here, entities would be asked to create transportation emissions reduction plans, report on plans to reduce their vehicle fleet emissions, and then reporting on gallons of fuel consumed in their owned and leased vehicles. So here I just emphasize this is the first time ever that CMS has proposed to collect emissions data from providers and represents a strong step forward in tackling the health sector's carbon footprint. And importantly, in developing this proposal, our team worked hard to align the reporting requirements with existing protocols and recommendations from industry and thought leaders. We also thought carefully about how to minimize the reporting burden by predominantly using a reporting system that hospitals and health systems are already familiar with, and EPA's Energy Star Portfolio Manager. And then for team model participants that choose to voluntarily report this data, we're proposing to share benchmarked data that will help participants identify opportunities to improve energy efficiency, lower greenhouse gas emissions, and drive practice transformation that leads to more sustainable operations. We're also proposing to offer public recognition for voluntary reporting, for example, a special badge on CMS websites, including those that are designed to offer patients more information on provider quality and performance. The last thing I'll touch on just very briefly, the second major element of the initiative is the development of rollout of technical assistance and learning system support for participants. This could include support for activities such as accessing resources provided under the Inflation Reduction Act, which Joe just highlighted a moment ago, compiling and disseminating best practices, and identifying and disseminating tools to help facilities more accurately report their emissions. The comment period for this rule is open until June 10th, and if you need more information or a link to find the proposal, as part of the Medicare inpatient payment rule for FY25 IPPS. In closing, I would just add here, we're very excited to take this first historic step, and we look forward to working with all of you as we move to finalize this proposal and explore new areas where the Innovation Center can play a role in pushing our sector towards a more sustainable, climate-resilient future. And with that, I'll transition us to our panel discussion, I believe.
Thank you, Michael. Thanks so much for your leadership and incredibly hard work in bringing that out into the world. And you know, I think the proposed program is just incredibly exciting. So I think what you've gotten there in the last few minutes from me and Michael is kind of some context on the challenge and potential supports from the government. But now we want to spend the balance of our time hearing from leading organizations that are taking advantage of these opportunities and showing real energy and creativity in terms of tackling the problem now. These are groups that give us a lot of confidence through their great work to improve climate health and to become more sustainable. And so I'm very happy to welcome Dr. Anna Goldman, who's a primary care physician and medical director of climate and sustainability at Boston Medical Center. Deepak Sadagopan, who is chief operating officer of population health at the Providence Health System. Reginald Vix, registered nurse and chief operating officer at Crescent Care in New Orleans. And then Joe Castiglione, who is on the industry initiatives team at Blue Shield of California. So they're going to jointly give us the provider and the payer perspective on how to approach this work. And I'm going to start with Anna, who's just led such beautiful work with her colleagues at Boston Medical Center. And I use that word intentionally because I think it's this combination of something very creative and good for the environment, but also deeply compassionate. So Anna, can you tell us about the Clean Power Prescription Program you started and how it intersects with some of the concepts of interest to the group here around value-based care payments and accountable care?
Yes, and thank you so much for having me on this panel today. It's really an honor to be here with you, Joe, and with everyone on this panel. So as Joe mentioned, I'm a primary care physician at Boston Medical Center. I'm medical director of climate and sustainability there. And we have a program called Clean Power Prescription, which I co-founded with our chief sustainability officer, Bob Biggio. It's a first of its kind pilot program that provides solar energy credits to BMC health system patients, so Boston Medical Center health system patients, who report difficulty affording their household utility payments. And the credits are generated by a 356 kilowatt solar array on our campus. And you can see a photograph of it right behind me in my Zoom background. Patients who are enrolled in our pilot receive a monthly credit on their electric bill totaling $600 over the course of 12 months. I want to note that the Inflation Reduction Act was really a decisive factor in making clean power prescription a reality. So originally the idea for clean power prescription came out of a conversation I had with Bob, our chief sustainability officer. I had approached him with the idea that we would lease roof space to a local nonprofit that was building cooperatively owned solar arrays on the roofs of community buildings. And I loved that idea because I saw it as an opportunity both to assist with energy costs for many of our patients who struggled with that, and also to generate passive income for them as owner operators of this cooperatively owned array. For various reasons, he couldn't lease space on our roof because the roofs of hospitals are very busy places, a lot of new technology going up there all the time, but he was in the process of constructing the array that you see behind me. And he really loved the idea of helping our patients. And he was aware of the new Inflation Reduction Act investment tax credits and the low-income communities bonus credit adder, which significantly offsets the cost of installing the solar. And so that was a really direct impact. It kind of changed the course of what we were doing at BMC to have the option to receive that investment tax credit with the adder, and allowed us to pursue this program that directly assists our patients. In terms of how value-based payment has impacted this program and other work that we do at Boston Medical Center, it's been huge. It really laid the groundwork for this program. Because, in general, I think 10 years ago, the idea of giving solar energy to patients, it would have felt outside of the purview of our role as a hospital. The idea of value-based payment has changed our frame of thinking around health-related social needs, from all the way from screening for them to seeing our own role in addressing them. Now that's become more second nature to us to think, okay, yeah, it is our role to address these things because we're an ACO and because that's what we do, it was a natural thing to add this to our already pretty substantial portfolio of programs housed at BMC that address health-related social needs. And we have a rooftop farm where we grow food for our patients and a food pantry where we give them food. And we have a program in our pediatrics department called Street Cred, where we refer patients for tax assistance and tax advice so they can get money in their pockets that they deserve, but often weren't getting because they couldn't navigate the tax system. So, and the list actually goes on quite a bit from there. So this is the latest in a large portfolio of programs that are addressing health-related social needs. And I mentioned about the screening. So that in 2017, BMC started screening for health-related social needs because of the ACO transition that we went through. And a question about utility insecurity is one of the questions that we started with. And so as a provider, all of my patients in our primary care clinic were being screened for health-related social needs. So we have a whole list of questions. It's about food insecurity, housing instability, many questions that are typical. And then, do you have difficulty paying your heater or electric bills? One of them. And so I became aware of this among my patients. And historically, we weren't doing a lot for those patients who screened positive. We could write letters for patients to avoid disconnection of utility service, because that's in Massachusetts, a provider can write a letter preventing that. And I was writing those frequently and actually wrote one earlier this week. So it's still something that we can do, but this sort of gets more at the root cause. And so this was really a motivator in helping me see this as an issue that we could address with our patients. And then finally, I'll just say that So we're running our pilot program through our complex care management program at BMC, which is actually through our health plan and is actually part of the ACO. So it's an intensive case management program for high utilizing patients who are using more than the average amount of emergency or inpatient care. And many of you would be familiar with the kind of like the hotspotters model of intensive case management around health-related social needs, right? So, and questions about utility and security were already part of their intensive screening that they do for new CCM patients. And so it was great because they have, a higher ratio of community health workers who can navigate a new program like this and kind of fold it into our operations and deal with any challenges that arise with a new program. So we're running it through a program that's specifically funded by flexible service dollars through MassHealth, so that we have the extra resources to kind of roll out a program like this. So many different ways that value-based payment has impacted our work, and we're appreciative.
Anna, thanks. Thanks for making those links and just for the inspirational work. It's such a twofer, improving sustainability and also improving the health and well-being of these populations by helping them with these utility costs. So thank you for sharing that. And I want to turn next to Deepak. Deepak, climate change is impacting communities along the West Coast, and your provider organizations are looking for assistance in navigating that reality. And you've all been a real leader in this space. So can you say more about what you're all doing in the value-based care space that addresses these challenges and positively impacts your patients and increases sustainability in your facilities?
Yeah, happy to. And thank you, Joe, for the opportunity to speak about this. Just as a quick introduction, my role in Providence is as Chief Operating Officer for Population Health. The Population Health function in Providence is responsible for the portfolio of value-based care programs across our system. We have, just for context, we have over 1.2 million lives under total cost of care risk across different lines of business, Medicare, Medicare Advantage, as well as Medicaid. So we have a pretty large population of patients that we are directly held accountable for, both in terms of outcomes and costs. So the journey to value is very, very real to us in the environments we sit in. And we operate the largest ACO in the country, north of about 150,000 Medicare beneficiaries. So at Providence, what we have done is under the leadership of our CEO, Dr. Rod Hochman, and Ali Santori, our Chief Environmental Stewardship Officer, we have set ourselves a really aggressive goal, actually, by getting to carbon negative by 2030. That's about 20 years in advance of the CMS goal. And we actually started on this journey quite early, a few years back, and we started measuring and reporting out on the progress towards going to carbon negative as early as in 2019, when we invested in creating our own internal system to kind of create scorecard and analyze our progress towards a goal, because we realized it was very real in some of our populations with the increasing prevalence of wildfires, drought, floods. I think our populations have experienced some of the most devastating impacts of climate change, and we felt a responsibility to kind of step in and contribute towards making a positive impact. And all our efforts to date, as part of this goal, we are aiming to reduce use renewable electricity throughout our family of organizations by 2030. More than 80 of our facilities already have made the move towards renewable energy. Our sustainable efforts have cut waste that are headed to landfills by more than 25%. By the end of the next decade, we'll divert more than 50% of waste from landfills. I mean, those are like some of the small early results that we've been able to deliver. And I think What we are also looking at is specifically as it relates to value-based care. The Population Health Organization, under our leadership, we've been able to set aside $50 million in our commitment to health equity and social related health needs for about 5 years. And we've been, and this is all an effort, I think, like stringing a common thread of beads from Anna, I think Anna's comments, I think we're all trying in our respective areas to create ways to create more flexibility in funding so that we can dive and we can invest those funds towards health related social needs that kind of have these kind of impacts on our populations. On a value-based care standpoint, I love the way you framed the impact of climate change on from a value-based care lens, Joe. And I would say we are in very early stages of actually really understanding total cost of care impact from an economic perspective as it relates to the impact of climate change events. As you rightly pointed out, apart from the social and the very real community and the personal costs that these imposed on our communities, there's also economic costs. There's unpredictable cost changes. There is that makes it very challenging, especially in a environment that is moving towards value-based care, to actually manage costs within a risk pool, right? Like so given our pretty large footprint in value-based care, I think we are starting to put in place the measures to really understand what these what the economic impact of these changes are, study that over a period of time, and then we're hoping to partner with your office as well as CMS to kind of provide inputs on and suggestions on how we can and work with our payers such as Shield here to create resources for our community in partnership so that we can weather through these challenges. So those are some of the things we do. Happy to go into more detail.
Thanks, Deepak. That's great. Well, there's a lot there already that's really rich. And yeah, we certainly will explore things more. But and I think, yeah, some of that information that you're collecting, you know, has a lot of potential power to it. So we'd love to learn more about that when it's ready. I want to turn next to Reginald Vix. You know, Reginald, I think this is the third webinar where I've interviewed you in the last few months, and it's just such a tribute to your great work and vision in New Orleans in both creating a health center that's more resilient and also more sustainable. So can you please tell us about the origin of your climate resiliency initiatives in New Orleans and why they're so important for your patients and your community?
Sure. Thanks for having me on the call. Always good to see you and everyone else working in this space. So Crescent Care is a federally qualified health center located in New Orleans, Louisiana. And we became part of a project called Community Lighthouse about a year and a half ago. It was a result of Hurricane Ida and its impact on the power grid in Southeast Louisiana and specifically in New Orleans. At that time, our agency was significantly impacted by Hurricane Ida, and the city of New Orleans lost power for about 9-10 days. Significant losses in power, acute care facilities, primary care organizations like us, and so on. And as a result, we could not provide services to the community. We provide complete wraparound services for our constituents. We serve about 14,000 unduplicated clients a year at two primary locations. And we provide significant wraparound services. So our food pantry couldn't operate. Our pharmacy lost a significant amount of product because the grid went down. Supply chain failed us, so we couldn't keep our generator, our traditional diesel generator, operating because we couldn't get fuel. Our clients could not make their primary care mental health or substance use disorder appointments because we couldn't operate the clinic. So just to give you a rough estimate, because it was probably more than this, when you look at total cost, of lost services, et cetera. We specifically lost about $250,000 worth of products because not only did our generator fail, which affected our cold storage, but our backup system failed as well because we had partners who also lost power like we did, unexpectedly. And so the Community Lighthouse Project actually sort of grew out of a sense of urgency around how we can maintain services for the most vulnerable individuals in our population. Many of our clients are homeless. We're the largest LGBTQ plus primary care organization in this area, actually in the state of Louisiana. And we have the largest gender affirming care clinic in the state of Louisiana and in this region. And so there are a lot of clients who were depending on us that we fail. And so when this project came online, and Crescent Care is one of the founding members of Together New Orleans, which is actually lifted up the Community Lighthouse Project, we were all in. So what we've done, first of all, we got rid of that diesel generator, gone, never to return. And we will never use another diesel generator at any of our facilities. And we leaned into solar backup generator power with a storage battery as part of our system. So we have solar panels on the roof of our building. Just to give you some context of that, our building is about 65,000 square feet, and a significant portion of the roof is covered with solar panels. So we can actually produce enough energy to operate continuously about 92% of our building just on solar. Not only that, we're giving power. The solar system that we have in place operates 24/7. So all day long, we're using solar and not pulling off the grid, and also giving back power to the grid. And so we've seen a significant impact on our monthly energy costs, electric bills, along with that confidence that we can operate our entire facility during a power outage. In addition to that, I'm the chief operations officer, and many times I get calls about facility issues. So not only did we do the solar component, but we also changed out the diesel generator to a natural gas generator that can actually power the whole facility. The really cool thing about it is that it works in conjunction with the solar. So if we don't have any sunlight, we lose power and the batteries are drained, the generator will kick on and actually power up, recharge the storage batteries in the solar system. And once it reaches a certain level, it will turn itself off. So designing the system like that, we tried to take into consideration our contribution to lowering the carbon footprint within our facility, as well as a system that would keep us operating continuously. This has really been super helpful. The Community Lighthouse Project that we're engaged in, the goal is to have about 185 of these resiliency hubs around the state. In the city of New Orleans, we're focused on 18 resiliency hubs at this point in the process. What that does for us is they're strategically placed so that the people in the neighborhood or in the vicinity would only have to walk about 10 minutes to get to us. And so we're working on a process right now to integrate the Community Lighthouse Project with the City of New Orleans Emergency Management Backup Plan, so that as a resiliency hub, we can also enhance the work that our city's emergency management department engages in during a disaster. And being in Hurricane Alley, essentially, in Southeast Louisiana, we experienced significant power outages at a higher frequency rate than we would like. In fact, we're third in the country for power outages, but we're number one for the length of power outages. So per outage. And so this has really been sort of a game changer for us, especially when you think about how individuals can access care continuously and stay out of the emergency room and stay out of the hospital as well. So I'll stop there, and you know, I'm happy to answer any questions as we move forward.
Thanks, Reginald. Yeah, I mean, you know, I think I've heard your story three or four times now, but it's equally powerful. And I think the vision for all of New Orleans is powerful, and this relationship between resilience and sustainability is just so clear in the way that you tell the story. So thank you for that. Finally, here, Joe, you know, I think we'd love to hear the payer perspective. And you know, your organization is one of the organizations that signed the White House HHS Health Sector Climate Pledge that I mentioned, as are a couple of others here with us today. And you're one of the few payer organizations to do so. So can you say a little more about what you know, what this means to your organization and what opportunities you see ahead that might positively impact your members' care or you know, the communities that your members are in?
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you so much for having me here today. It's great to be here with you all. I mean, it's tough to follow Reginald with that story. I mean, I think it grounds the conversation in, you know, the human condition, right? Like the reason so many of us got into healthcare. Tough act to follow. I will do my best. So that pledge is it's really a reflection of our leadership's recognition of the climate crisis. Our CEO is also on record talking about this, but it's really our commitment to leveraging our unique role as financiers within the health system to both reduce emissions and build and strengthen resilience across the provider networks that serve our members. And you know, as you were talking, Joe, at the beginning of the conversation, I mean, the impact of the crisis on communities, on our communities, on communities across the country is clear, right? Like we could spend the entire hour just discussing the consequences of wildfires, of heat waves, of floods, of sea levels rising, right? The list goes on, and we know that it both increases utilization and impedes access. And of course, like virtually every crisis, healthcare and otherwise, you know, it disproportionately impacts communities of color and with low income. But as you noted, you know, when you look at that White House pledge and the signatories on that pledge, it's a whole lot of providers and not a whole lot of payers. And that's, you know, perhaps not surprising since providers do see, as we've heard, like firsthand the human suffering that's rooted in this crisis. But it's ironic, right? Because as an insurance company, our entire business model is predicated on the ability to predict risk and bring products to market which reflect that risk. That is our core function. And yet it's evident, again, as you've heard today, that providers as a sector are, or I should say as a whole, are further along in seeing this risk than payers, right? Like they providers see the impact of the crisis, and they also see the impact of facilities, of procedures, of clinical choices, which helped make up that, you know, I think you said 9% of US greenhouse gas emissions that the system, you know, produces. And as the financial arm of the health system, payers shape many of those choices, right? Like the system writ large is a reflection of its funding. So it's incumbent upon us, and we see it as incumbent upon us as a funding source to support and incentivize the sort of system transformation needed to reduce emissions and build resilience. And I think in particular, you know, driving toward opportunities that align incentives, which not only enhance sustainability, but also, you know, reduce cost or improve quality of patient experience, you know, health equity. Ideally, you know, all of the above. And that's, I think that sounds like a tall order because it very much is, but that's why we're here. That's why we signed that pledge. It's fundamentally what that pledge is about for us, right? So it's leveraging our role, particularly through financing, to drive material systemic change in a way that better serves both our providers and our members. And I'd love to talk about, a couple ideas that we have for what those levers might look like, but maybe we'll continue the conversation and those will come up organically.
Joe, thank you for that. I really appreciate it. And yeah, appreciate your perspective on why this is actually so very relevant to payer organizations. Would love to hear those additional ideas you have as well. Just to kind of open the floor to the group for a few questions, and maybe one or two people would like to answer each of these questions before we close. We've kind of touched on this peripherally, but when you think of all the groups that are kind of implicated in the response to climate change, what does multi-stakeholder alignment look like and in climate change and value-based care? And what are the most important areas where we need to align to achieve better outcomes and avoid burden? Any thoughts about that from the group?
I'm happy to go for it, Deepak.
Go for it, Joe. Okay, you got there first.
Okay, sure. So I'd like to answer this question in part because I work on a fairly novel concept at Blue Shield California called industry initiatives. We sit at the intersection of policy and industry, right? So public-private partnerships that help to drive alignment around key areas of interest to Blue Shield, namely value-based payments. So how do we drive stakeholder alignment around payment models, in particular for primary care? So that's really the lens through which I come at this conversation. And I think, in terms of opportunities, Blue Shield is still in a sort of nascent stage of our journey on this issue. I think there are ample opportunities around, specific specialties, procedures, drugs. And we have some additional ideas about the levers that are available to us, particularly within value-based payment, but even just starting with some basic data collection, right? Like, we have a lot of work to do as a payer just to get a baseline assessment of the resilience within our provider network. There are, I think, a number of state and federal regulations which may eventually help with that. But as payers, that's, I think, a good place for us and in general for other payers to start. And on specific models, payment models, I think I'd emphasize that we are for now looking to the evidence. So what does the GI Society have to say about endoscopies? Where can we reduce single-use devices and unnecessary procedures? Where can we incentivize home-based procedures where clinically appropriate? What does the Society of Anesthesiologists have to say about the use of desflurane, right? The most potent greenhouse gas there is, and other sort of inhaled anesthetics that I think you talked about at the beginning, Joe. Like, could it be removed from formularies? Could we develop a medical policy or a payment model to incentivize different clinical choices? I think there are a number of areas that we're looking at, but at a minimum, I think we do very much feel, like I said, it's within our business interest to align financial incentives toward models and delivery systems that lower clinical and operational waste. And it all has to be done in partnership, in collaboration with our providers and hopefully other payers, right? To sort of collectively determine which opportunities best balance sustainability with cost, patient safety, provider burnout, and a number of other important dimensions.
So thank you for that. Deepak.
Yeah, I think Joe did a remarkable job in kind of highlighting the path forward on what a collaborative framework looks like. I would add that I think as we discuss collaboration across, it needs to be a cross-stakeholder kind of conversation in the community. I think the payer and the provider certainly play a part in this, but so do employers, so do other stakeholders in community-based organizations that have a stakeholder in community health, that have a that have a voice in this space, need to kind of come to the table to kind of really figure out how we are collectively going to address this issue for our communities, because an adverse event on climate change is impactful to everybody around that table, right? Again, and so I think we need what would be great is if we can create like a collective action framework that is cross line of business that really focuses on creating a pool of resources that are community based that can that can then be aligned towards not only upfront interventions and building resiliency in our communities so that they can weather through these changes and the adverse impacts associated with it. I mean, things like non-health related issues, like if wildfires, we've seen like so many families lose their transportation means, like cars and, you know, like even places to live and things like that. So how do you create potentially reinsurance pools or kind of things to help them regain that mode of mobility so that they can actually gain access to healthcare? Because I think it's a foundational problem for many of our communities. And I think we do need to think broader in terms of aligning resources across different segments of our the stakeholder community. So.
Great. Thanks, Deepak. Some great ideas in there. Just looking at the time, you know, to close, I'd love to ask each of the panelists, if I could, just for some closing remarks about, you know, imagine the people who are listening to this session and kind of newer to this work and want to get more into the intersection of climate change and value-based care and thereby advance equity and justice for these communities, the things we've been talking about. What would be your advice? What should they consider? How can they prepare? Maybe I'll just turn to you first, Reginald, and we can just go around the group. Just a minute of your starting thoughts for an organization like that.
So I think that some of the lessons learned for us would center around engage in a project like this, especially since so many of us are unfamiliar with the technology when it comes to solar and renewable energy sources. I think that for us, setting up the network for community lighthouses here in New Orleans is really a critical piece, and getting federally qualified health centers engaged in this transition, if you will, and understanding the impact. You know, community health centers serve about, you know, 31 million people across the country. So it's a true safety net. And it's important that we keep that safety net open for business, because a lot of people would fall through the cracks without us.
Thanks, Reginald. That's great. Anna, how about you? Any just quick reflections for those who are getting underway?
Yeah, I mean, I think for us, it's been incredibly mission aligned. I didn't mention at the beginning, we're the largest safety net hospital in New England, and it's been good. It's been good for us at so many levels, including staff morale and faculty recruitment, and then just our patients are so excited to hear that we're doing it. So there's that level. I also think that people should keep in mind that sustainability is about stewardship of resources and more efficient use of resources. And at BMC, there's really been a strong business case for it. We did a major redesign of our campus starting in 2012, in which we reduced our total square footage by 300,000 square feet, but actually increased our patient volume by 20%. So we downsized but upsized our patient volume. That saved us a ton of money. I could present more on that another time, but and it's really been the bedrock on which we've done further investment in sustainability. So it's a first step, is to think about stewardship of resources and a place to start.
Thanks, Anna. That's a great idea. Deepak or Joe, any final thoughts that you'd want to share before I wrap us up?
Looks like Deepak, you're on mute.
Oh, sorry. Happy to. I was just going to say that, you know, I think we should acknowledge that hospitals and provider entities across the country are going through an unusually difficult time as it relates to financial sustainability across the country. And the first thing that that often occurs to mind from an operational standpoint is that this is one additional thing they need to think about as kind of when they are confronted with a very difficult situation. I would suggest to them that this think of the climate change initiative as actually aligned with your overall financial recovery plans, because you know think the environmental stewardship kind of initiatives that Anna referred to, some of the things that Joe referred to as well, and Reginald, I think really actually align more closely with cost optimization and kind of resource alignment, cross-community resource alignment type initiatives may actually alleviate the journey towards getting to sustainability from a healthcare delivery standpoint. So I was seeing action on this front as part of the solution and not part of the broader set of headwinds that are confronting your system. Maybe I think is probably the first step to take, and then devising your strategy along the way. So,
Deepak, thanks. That's a great framing. Joe, any final quick thoughts?
Yeah, I'll keep it quick. I just want to have a call to action to payers. I think it's very easy, you know, to say, oh, we're an insurance company. We don't produce emissions. Like all we have to do is get our building certified, you know, LEED certified, and we'll call it a day. But you know, I think that's a naive point of view. You know, I think as you heard Anna say, it's really about resource stewardship, right? Like as a resourcing entity, payers exist for that purpose. And so we have to recognize our role in shaping the system that we have. And simply from a business model perspective, right? Like we have to account for both our impact and the impact on us. And we just cannot afford to ignore either. So grateful to be here with you all today and to be part of this discussion.
Thank you, Joe. And thank you to all our panelists so much. Hopefully, you know, serious as this challenge is and as urgently as actions required, hopefully you're left with a sense of the real change that's possible, as I am, and you have some great places to start, I think. And hopefully, too, you're intrigued by some of the opportunities we referenced at the top of the session and want to take a closer look at the IRA, for example, and its tax credits and grants and other programs that can make this feel like more of an opportunity than a burden, to sort of paraphrase Deepak there. So thank you all too for tuning in. And with that, we'll wrap up. I just want to encourage people in the audience to take a brief 1-minute survey that will appear when you leave the webinar. If you could do that, it'll be really informative to us. And we thank you all again for being with us today. Thanks, everybody.
Thank you all.
Thank you.